Take your Bibles and turn with me to Ecclesiastes chapter 7. Ecclesiastes chapter 7. Start a series on wisdom. Ecclesiastes chapter 7. If you would please stand for the reading of God's word if you are able this evening. Ecclesiastes chapter 7. Begin reading verse 1. It says, "Good name is better than precious ointment, in the day of death than the day of one's birth. It is better to go to the house of mourning than to go to the house of feasting. For that is the end of all men, and the living will lay it to his heart. Sorrow is better than laughter, for by sadness of the countenance the heart is made better. The heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of fools is in the house of mirth. It is better to hear the rebuke of the wise than for a man to hear the song of fools. For as the crackling of thorns under a pot, so is the laughter of the fool. This also is vanity. Surely oppression maketh a wise man mad, and a gift destroyeth the heart. Better is the end of a thing than the beginning thereof, and the patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. Be not hasty in thy spirit to be angry, for anger resteth in the bosom of fools. Say not thou, what is the cause that the former days were better than these? For thou dost not inquire wisely concerning this." There again, verse 10, notice it says, "Say not thou, what is the cause of the former days were better than these?" Many times we think about things being better and how we'd like it to be better. And there is a way to make things better. We want to talk about that, and that's called wisdom. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for loving us. Thank you, Lord, for the Word of God. And I pray that you would strengthen us tonight and draw us near to you. Lord, we do need wisdom. Lord, there's a lot of knowledge in our day, but very little wisdom. So I pray, Lord, that you would strengthen us and guide us through the Word of God. Challenge our hearts for this, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Be seated. There's a lot that people would call wisdom that is not really wisdom. Just because you could take a formula and figure out how to make something doesn't mean that you're wise. Just because you can sit down and maybe read two or three different languages doesn't mean that you're wise. Just because you have several degrees tacked on to the end of your name, it doesn't make you wise, doesn't mean you're wise. There's a major difference between knowledge and wisdom. And today we're ever learning and ever coming to the knowledge, the Bible says. And yet we don't understand the things of God and have the power of God on our lives. We're living in a day and time, it's called an information age. It used to be that, you know, you had to, everybody in their home, they had a set of books called encyclopedias. Man, I tell you what, for the past few years, you could go to house after house when they're having yard sales and you can buy encyclopedias because nobody has them, nobody uses them anymore. Everybody has the internet. And they get on the internet, and like we said the other night, you know everything on the internet's got to be true. And so they do all their searches on the internet because it's a lot easier than getting a book out and having to read to find where you're going. They just type in something and it pulls it up, or for all kinds of articles and all types of things about it. And we live in the information age. Back a few years ago when there was a lot of the bombing and different threats, bombing threats in America going on, we had a boy that, I don't know, this is just the way he did. He came to school one day and he had these plans. He said, "Hey, Brother Haggett, look at this." And I said, "What you got, William?" And he said, "Hey," he said, I got plans of how to build a bomb. I said, "You what?" He said, "I got it off the internet." I said, "They're probably watching those sites and they'll probably come to your house tomorrow." And you can get anything off the internet. It's crazy. And so we live in the information age. And people can talk about so many different things, and the knowledge is rampant, and I mean we've excelled everything that used to be large to make it. Now they can make it miniature because of the knowledge that they have. But we are lacking in wisdom. In wisdom. When I was in school, there was a teacher in school that he was a science teacher, and he was an ace at physics, and he was an ace at chemistry, and he majored these things out when he was in college, and he could teach it. And the problem with taking any of these classes is that he was so smart that when he began to teach, he was teaching you on a college level when you was in high school. But he didn't have enough sense to get out of the rain. Not enough wisdom. And so many times today we attribute knowledge with wisdom, and that's not necessarily the case. I believe with wisdom comes knowledge. I can take you back a few years, and I know of different men that never graduated from high school. Maybe had a sixth grade education or a seventh grade education or eighth grade education. And they'll be some of the wisest men that you would ever talk to. I mean wise. Knew how to do multiple of things, and they was wise, and they could confound those who had all the book learning in that subject or in that area. But they had wisdom. We find here that Solomon is talking about wisdom here. And in chapter 1, actually Solomon begins to bemoan all the wisdom that he was getting and all the wisdom that he's seen, and he calls it vanity. If you look back in chapter 1, verse 16, he says, "And I communed with mine own heart, saying, Lo, I am come to a great estate and have gotten more wisdom than all they that have been before me in Jerusalem. Yea, my heart had great experience of wisdom and knowledge. And I gave my heart to know wisdom and to know madness and folly. I perceive that this also is vexation of spirit." Verse 18, he says, "For in much wisdom..." Now notice what he says here. This is strange. But he says, "For in much wisdom is much grief. And he that increaseth knowledge increaseth sorrow." And in the beginning of Ecclesiastes, probably outside of Jesus Christ, the wisest man that has ever walked the face of the earth, begins to bemoan wisdom. He says that with wisdom came sorrow and grief, because he said, the more that I knew, he said, the sadder I got. The more wisdom that I had, he said, the more grief that it seemed to lay in my heart and life. And he said it would be better to be simple and ignorant. We've all heard the old saying, ignorance is bliss. It's almost as though Solomon in the beginning there in chapter 1 all the way up to almost chapter 6, he's bemoaning wisdom. But when he gets down to the latter part of chapter 6, it seems as though he begins to understand real wisdom. He begins to see it as it should be. And he begins to ask himself some questions in chapter 6, verse 11 and 12. He says, "Seeing there be many things that increase vanity, what is a man? Is man the better?" He said, with all these things, he said, with all this wisdom and all these this knowledge and all these things that we come up with, he said, does it make man better? Is man any better? Verse 12, and he's asking a question, he's asking himself. Verse 12 says, "For who knoweth what is good for man in this life?" Who really knows what's good for you? And he's pondering it in his heart, and he's asking the question. Here's the man that has the greatest wisdom in the world, and he's asking himself, he's saying, who really knows what's best for man? All the days of his vain life, which he spendeth as a shadow. And he talks about how short life is. And it's a shadow, and that it seems as though, have you ever seen an animal, a dog or a cat, chase their shadow, try to catch their shadow? And he's talking about that shadow of that man that you can't even catch your own shadow. And he's talking about, he's asking the questions here. And he goes on and says, "For who can tell a man what shall be after him under the sun?" Can you tell me what's going to happen after the sun goes down? Can you tell me what's going to happen tomorrow? We can't. But he begins to ask these questions, and from whom and where can I get these answers, he's saying. And now all of a sudden he's beginning to see, you know, it's not from me that I get the understanding. It's not from me that I get the wisdom, but it's from God that I get the wisdom. And I need wisdom from God to answer the questions of life and to direct my life, he's saying. Wisdom won't solve all of life's problems and troubles. But let me say something. It can make it better. It can make it better. It's possible for you to have a better life. I'm not preaching some type of prosperity gospel here, but it's possible for you to have a better life. It's possible for you to have a better marriage. It's possible for you to have a better tomorrow, a better family, a better finances. But as much as you pray for those things, and we do pray for those things, Lord, help our finances, or help our relationships, or help our marriage, or help our children, we pray for those things. But can I tell you something? If God was to give you those things, whether it be more money or whatever, you wouldn't be able to handle those things. I wouldn't be able to handle those things without wisdom. And they wouldn't last. Amen. And so we need wisdom. And through wisdom we can have, if you want to say, a better life. We can have a better finances. We can have a better family life. We can have a better marriage. We can have, and on goes the list. But we have to have the wisdom in order to be able to handle those things. This nation has been handed so many great things over the years, and because of the lack of wisdom, we have ruined it. And we are in great debt. America should never have been in the debt that she's in. America should have been able to be debt-free and carry itself. But because of the lack of wisdom, we have squandered what God has blessed us with. We need wisdom. Wisdom walks the aisles of this church and every church and says, "Will you answer my call?" In Proverbs chapter 1, and it was Solomon that wrote Proverbs also. But in Proverbs chapter 1, begin verse 20, says, "Wisdom crieth without." Wisdom's crying continually to you and me. "She utteth her voice in the streets. She crieth in the chief place of concourse, in the openings of the gates, and in the city. She uttereth her words, saying, How long, you simple ones?" We love simplicity. "And the scorners delight in their scorning, and fools hate knowledge." It says, "Turn you at my reproof. Behold, I will pour out my spirit unto you. I will make known my words unto you." And so wisdom, which is God, calls out unto us saying, "I want you to receive my words. I want you to receive my direction. I want you to receive wisdom." Even beyond salvation, He wants us to have an understanding. See, how are you going to make it in this wicked world without wisdom? Do you know why a lot of Christians fall? It's because they don't have any wisdom. Do you know why a lot of problems come into our lives as a Christian that we could avoid? It's because we don't have any wisdom. Do you know why it's hard to build churches today? It's because there's a lack of wisdom. We need wisdom. In the world that calls evil good and good evil and applauds unrighteousness, hey, listen, we need wisdom of how to live. We need wisdom of how to act and how to conduct ourselves day in and day out. If somebody was walk up to you on the street today and say, "Do you believe that homosexuality is all right?" What would your answer be? You would probably say, "Well, no, I don't think it's right." And then say, "Why?" "Well, my preacher says it's not right. The Bible says it's not right." Give me some wisdom. Every day, we are faced with situations that we need wisdom as Christians. Not just some pat answer we've heard somebody say, but we need some wisdom. To live in such a way that we bring honor and glory to God. Too many things are happening this day and time, and a lot of it's taking place, and it's because we've not taken a hold of wisdom. You got to have wisdom. You need the mind of God. To have wisdom is to have the mind of God. And what he's talking about there is in Philippians 2:5, he says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." How we think about things, our attitude towards things, our spirit towards things, the mind of Christ. Instead of a mind that is saturated with this world and saturated with the junk of this world, we need that wisdom. It's not God's fault that things are not better in our lives. God's good, isn't He? All the time. But to be honest with ourselves, we're not good. In fact, the Bible says there's none good. And so how can I be better? How can I be good if I'm no good? I've got to have the mind of Christ. I have to have God's goodness in my life. You may be saved, but thinking like God is not natural, is it? Just stop for a moment. Somebody comes up and, boy, they just begin to tear into you and chew into you. Do you think like God thinks? Probably not. Somebody walks up and they're mad and they kick the side of your car and put a dent in it. Do you think like God thinks? Probably not. Somebody does something, says something about your children. Do you have the mind of God? No, but you're going to give them a piece of your mind, right? It's not natural. Though you're saved, it is not natural to have the mind of God. You see, justification snatched you from hell. Sanctification begins to conform you into the image of Christ, setting you apart. The Holy Spirit that dwells within you is to help to lead and guide you and to bring honor and glory to God. But my friend, we must have the wisdom of God. So therefore, we must have the mind of Christ in our thinking, in the way that we perceive things, in the way that we look at things, because we look at this world through the eyes of the flesh. We look at this at things through the eyes of the worldliness that we've been raised in. Instead of the wisdom of God. We need the wisdom of God. You see, you get wisdom by getting to know God. The more you know Him, the more you'll understand. The more that we know Him, I'm talking about a relationship with Him. The more the wisdom that we have, you get wisdom by not only knowing Him better, but by walking with Him. If I want to know more about you and if I want to know you better, I need to spend time with you. It might be in those times when nobody else is around and we might be sitting on a riverbank fishing and it seemed like such a menial thing, but you begin to learn something about somebody else. My friend, I want you to know something. In the weakest hours of your life and in those difficult times of your life and when you're walking with God, when nobody else is around, I'm not talking necessarily about the preaching service. I'm not talking about the Sunday school service. I'm talking about when you and God's alone and you're spending time with Him, you begin to know Him in a greater way. But the sad part is that many of us don't walk with Him and we don't listen to Him and we don't talk to Him except on Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. Oh, how we need that walking with Him to understand and have the wisdom of God in our lives and begin to see how He thinks about things. Most of the time, not always, but most of the time, if you want to know how I think about something, ask my wife. Why? Because we have spent 36 years together and we begin to know one another a little bit better. And she, whether she agrees with me or not, she pretty well know most of the time what I'll say. Now that doesn't mean that I'd say what's right, but she'd probably tell you what I'd say. Now she might say, well, he'll say this when he really ought to say. Now she wouldn't do that either. But we generally know you get wisdom by studying the Word of God. In Colossians 3:16 says, "Let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord." Getting into the Word of God, putting the Word of God in our hearts and lives, understanding it and seeking the presence of the Lord and getting wisdom from God. You get wisdom by yielding to the Spirit of God. The Bible says that if we're going to live in the Spirit, we ought to walk in the Spirit. You know, there's a big difference between saying, okay, I'm going to live and let the Holy Spirit guide and direct me. And there's a big difference between that and allowing Him to. Walking in the Spirit. Preach, how you walk in the Spirit? You begin to acknowledge the Holy Spirit of God and ask Him to lead you. You may be trying to make a decision and you stop and say, Lord, Holy Spirit, what should I do? And we begin to walk in the Spirit, acknowledging the presence of God. You say, well, preacher, that just seems strange. I mean, is the Holy Spirit going to say out loud to you, do this, do that? No, but there's that unction of the Holy Spirit that begins to speak to your heart and gives you peace or takes a peace away or gives you direction and an understanding and a moving of your spirit. The Bible says His Spirit bears witness with our spirit. So if we want the wisdom of God, why not listen to the Spirit of God? And begin to allow Him to guide us and direct us and that we can have the wisdom and have understanding. Because see, man's ways and God's ways are not the same. Hey, listen, so much of what we do is not God's way. God's really the only source of wisdom. He tells us in James 1:5, He says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him what? Ask of God. He said, if you don't have wisdom, He said, why don't you ask the Lord? He goes on, He says, that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given to him. He said, ask me for some wisdom. And yet today we're spending money, we're going here, we're going there, we're doing this, we're doing that, without even asking God. And we wonder why our lives are in a mess, and we wonder why we fall into sin, and we wonder why our finances are in a mess, and we wonder why, and we wonder why. And yet we don't ask God for wisdom. Many times a lot of things could be settled if we would just ask the Lord for some wisdom in those areas. God told us to ask for wisdom. If we want to profit in this life and the next one, we need wisdom. Without wisdom, what good is all the things of this life and not knowing how to handle those things? If you prayed for $100,000 and God gave you $100,000, if you didn't have wisdom in handling it, it's going to be blown real quick and you're going to say, man, what happened to that money? I've known of people who have been injured and there was lawsuits involved, and I know of a man right now. I could call his name, and he's actually a preacher, and he's of a different denomination, but he was in an accident and it kind of crippled him up, and he got a million dollar settlement. And probably right now he lives week to week. He's pastor in a church and he's a police chief in a town. And he used to have $1 million. My friend, I'll tell you what, without the wisdom and direction of God, it doesn't matter what you've got. It doesn't matter. We'd be better off with a lot less and have the wisdom of God and handle it and get it a lot farther, and it'll go take us a lot farther than not have the wisdom of God and have everything. Amen. I want us to look here in chapter 7 now, how it profits us. Look at verse 1. It says, a good name is better than precious ointment. Solomon's saying here, he said, virtue is better than valuables. Virtue is better than anything else that you can have. He said a good name is better than precious ointment or something that's valuable. He said you'd be better off with a good name. Hey, you say, well, preacher, what are you talking about? I'm talking about, hey, listen, if somebody knows you, and you tell them something, do they believe you? Hey, telling the truth is so important today. There's people that they'll tell you something and you go, yeah, you don't know whether to tell the truth or not. And people who have no character. Virtue is more valuable than all the precious things that you can buy in this life. He's saying, listen, your testimony is so important. It's so important that you tell the truth, that you live with character, and that you keep your word, and that you stay above reproach and have that testimony that glorifies God. He said it's better than having an enormous amount of wealth. It's better than having all the valuable things of this world. He said you'd be better off with a good name, virtue. I remember as a kid, you didn't sign all these papers and do all this stuff. It didn't take you 30 days to buy a house. It took about 30 minutes. A lot of people, they just walked up and they shook on it. And that was their bond. That was their seal. Why? Because there was character. There was truthfulness. There was virtue. There was trust. Now we live in day and time. You'll have people look you straight in the eye and say, hey, I'll be there tomorrow at 10 o'clock. You can forget it. They're not showing up. You can have people that'll say, hey, listen, can I borrow $5 from you today? I'll give it back to you tomorrow. You can forget it. You'll never get it back. There's people's word is just absolutely no good. Everybody in this room knows of somebody. If somebody called their name, you'd say, phew, because of their character. Can I tell you something? Wisdom tells us that you'd be better off to have the good name. How do you do it? You wake up every morning. You read your Bible. You walk with God. You do right in this sin-cursed world. You don't turn to the right or to the left. You stay centered on the Lord. More important than all the stuff of this world is that you do what's right. More important than money. I've seen Christians throw their values out for the money. I've seen Christians sacrifice their families and everything else for a car or for something else or for money or whatever it is. But can I tell you that one day it's all going to disappear? It's all going to burn up. And the only thing that matters is how you live for God. Wisdom says a good name is better than precious ointment. It's better. God will bless your life if you keep that virtue. Matthew 6:33 says, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Hey, listen, if you'll serve God, God will take care of the other things. That doesn't mean you're going to be a millionaire. That doesn't mean you're going to have $100,000 in the bank. But God will take care of those things. He said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and then all these other things, He said, God will bless you with them. God can bless you. But have enough wisdom to seek the Lord first. Solomon goes on here and talks about your ending is better than your beginning. What? Look at verse 1 again. The latter part he says, and the day of death than the day of one's birth. Now that's strange. Solomon's saying, the day that you die is better than the day you're born. He said, preacher, this is the wisest man, to walk the face of the earth outside of Jesus Christ. God gave him wisdom, and he's beginning to understand wisdom, and he says, you know what? He said, the day that I die is better than the day that I was born. When a child is brought into this world, they're brought into all the junk, all the trials, all the tribulation, all the difficulties, all the cares, and all the junk of this world. And it's getting junkier all the time. And so when that child comes forth from the womb, from that day forth, there is a struggle. And can I say, even while that child is in the womb, that there's a struggle? Because now you've got doctors that are doing sonograms and they're saying, well, this is not a perfect baby, and it has this deformity or it has this problem. You need to abort the child. He says, the day that child's born begins sorrow. But the day that you die, as a Christian, you step into the presence of God. You say, but preacher, what about all that life? The greatest that it will ever be, and it takes wisdom to understand this, the greatest day is not the day you're born, but the day that you step out of here, if you know Christ. Because you are then in the presence of a holy God. No more sorrow. No more pain. No more struggling. No more cares of this world. No more struggles that go on. There's a lot to be gained in our lives by understanding that, and to see the day of death is better than the day of one's birth, and that last day of life is better than the first day of life. And on the first day we enter into that, but we find that in 2 Corinthians 5:8 it says, for we are confident and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Can I tell you something? As a Christian, most people struggle with this thought. It would be better to be in the presence of God. But to really know God is to know that it would be better to be in the presence of God. Away from all the struggles of life. Wisdom gives you that. Knowledge does not give you that. Knowledge says, man, live it to your fullest here. Get everything you can. Because one of these days you're going to wind up with cancer and you're going to be struggling, you'll be in pain, and boy, it just gets worse. No, I want to tell you something. Hey, listen, if you know Christ as your Savior, it just gets better. But you're not going to get that in a textbook. And you're not going to get that on Wikipedia or the internet. But you'll get that from the wisdom of God and understanding that the process that God has is to bring you into His presence. Life is not about us. Life is about Him. And the sooner we get to Him, the better it gets. Oh, I'm not saying... You say, well, preacher, are you wanting to die right now? No, no, because my flesh wants to live. But wisdom gives us an understanding that things will just be better for the Christian. Look at verse 2. It kind of goes along with that. So he's talking about a funeral is better than a feast. What? It says, it is better to go to the house of mourning than to the house of feasting. For that is the end of all men, and the living will lay it to heart. You see, the Lord wants to use all of us, whether it be in life or in death, really both. And He's saying that it would be better to go to the place of a funeral in that mourning than to be all excited about the things of this world and feasting and everything. You see, in Philippians 1:2 says, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. But it's hard for us to grasp those ideas because we are anchored so much into this world And the more that we have a hold of in this world, the harder it is for us to understand that we need to turn loose of this world and take a hold of what God has for us. Our hands are so full. Why are we seeing so many struggles in Christians' lives? It's because our hands are so full. We're not really turned loose of it and ready to go to the presence of God. Hey, you say, well, preacher, I don't want to die. I don't want to die either. I really want the rapture is what I want. I'm a wuss when it comes to dying. I'm not interested in it. I'm not afraid to die. It's like I told him yesterday at the hospital, I am not afraid to die. I just don't care about the process. I just soon have the rapture. But every Christian, if we're smart enough, we'll have our hands empty and ready to go. Because when our hands are empty and ready to go, then we can live this life to its fullest. Because we're not tied to it. We're not fearful of losing something that's in our hands. And we can begin to enjoy what God has for us. Doesn't mean that we're wanting to die. It just means that, hey, listen, I've turned loose of it. We live so tied to this world. Man, we need to turn loose of it and live for God. And to follow Him. So he tells us it's better to understand that for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Hopefully, you know, causing others even to come to a place in their lives that they'll see a need in their lives to get saved. Hey, I tell you what, at my funeral, I don't know who's preaching, but I want to tell you something. They better be preaching hot and heavy salvation or I'm going to sit up in that casket and do it myself. Tell you what we need. We need to turn loose of this world. Look at verse 3. Solomon goes on. He says, sorrow is better than laughter. Verse 3 says, sorrow is better than laughter. For by the sadness of the countenance, the heart is made better. What? By the sadness of the countenance, the heart is made better. He goes on, verse 4, he says, the heart of the wise is in the house of mourning, but the heart of fools is in the house of mirth. There's a lot to be gained in our lives by adversity. Most of us, and including myself, we don't like adversity, do we? Do you like it when things go tough? Do you like when there's troubles? No, we don't like it. We don't like it when you get up of a morning and you go out and you stick the key in the vehicle to go to work and you turn the key and it goes click. Oh, we get mad. We don't like it when we go to the freezer and to get some ice and we open it up like that and water begins to run out. We don't like it on those hot days we come home, we've been out, it's hot and everything, and you walk in the house waiting for that air conditioner to hit you in the face and you walk in and it's like 10 degrees hotter in the house than it is outside. And you hear something outside just going, hum. And then you hear something go, click. And the breaker kicks. And we're thinking, oh. And so we walk over and we get the mail and we look at it. Bill, 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 Bill. I don't know who lives in my house that was ever named Bill, but he gets a lot of mail. We don't like that adversity, do we? But you know what the Lord said? That's how you're going to grow. That's how you can learn to trust me. And so he said, it's better for us to go through adversity than to always be partying and happy. The world is always looking for a bigger and better party. They're always looking to be excited about everything and to under. Hey, listen, you know what, Blake? Hey, do you like having fun? Do you Do you ever have days that you don't have fun and you just don't know what to do? You know what? That's good for you. What? Make you appreciate the good days. Do you like to fish? Do you like catching fish? Do you like it when you go out and you fish for 2 hours and you don't even get a bite? No, but sure make you appreciate when you go out and start catching them, doesn't it? Did you get that shotgun yet? No, but you appreciate it when you get it. Work, save your money, then you can buy it. And you'll appreciate it. Do you want a lot of parents do today? 16. Bought your new car today. Paid all the insurance up on it. 2016 Mustang. Candy apple red. Fire stripes down the side. They go out and buy their kids a brand new car. First thing kid does, gets out there and he rips it up and down the street, runs it into the side of something. You walk out there, there's chicken bones in the back seat, Taco Bell cups, dirty shoes, sweaty socks. Parvey's ball uniform hanging on the mirror. He don't care about that car. He didn't have to work for it. But adversity, having to work, makes you appreciate it. The difficult days in our lives helps us to trust the Lord. Helps us to grow closer to Him. We'll gain that wisdom as we face the troubles and the trials of life, as we seek the hand of the Lord and we learn to trust the Lord. We don't take a... Did you ever stop and think about when things are going good, you don't look at yourself real close. If everything's going good in your life, man, you're not worried about if there's sin in your life. You're not worried about if you got a problem. Man, you're just enjoying life. But you let everything come crashing down around you and you begin to cry and you begin to hurt. You begin to say, Lord, is there something wrong? What do I need to learn out of this? I was talking to my aunt. She just now got to go back home and she's just now getting where she can walk and everything. And she said the other day, she said, I don't know what the Lord's trying to show me, but He's trying to show me something. Trying to show me something. Or no, it wasn't her. It was Lucille. That's what it was. It was Lucille. It wasn't her. It was Lucille. I talked to her yesterday on the phone and she was sick and she said, I don't know what it is. She said, the Lord is trying to tell me something. When we don't feel good, when the difficulties come, that's when we begin to call on God and say, Lord, what's going on? Amen. But during the good times, we're just like, whew, and we don't try to get closer to God. And so the psalm in here is telling us, hey, listen, sorrow is better than laughter. We need Him more. And we need less of ourselves. And then lastly, correction is better than a compliment. Correction. Look at verse 5. It says, it is better to hear the rebuke of the wise than for a man to hear the song of fools. For the crackling of the thorns under a pot, so is the laughter of the fool. This is also vanity. You know what? Sometimes people just come along all the time and they're just slapping us on the back. Good job, good job, good job. Man, you just are perfect. Man, I tell you what, you're so good. Man, I tell you. You're wonderful. You're fantastic. Man, there's nobody like you. Nobody could ever do that like you do that. Man. Can I have your autograph? And you're sitting there. Well, when somebody comes along and says, I think you could have done a better job. There's over there where you did that weed eating. I found a spot like that you missed. If you don't mind, go get the weed eater. Go do it. And we're like, but it teaches us. And it builds us. Do you know what they'll teach you? Next time I'm weed eating, I'm going to get it. That preacher ain't going to find nothing that ain't been cut down. Rose bushes and all. But rebuke. Did you weed eat? I don't know if you weed up. But you know what? Sometimes we don't like to be corrected. But you know what the Lord said? That correction is better than somebody bragging on you. I'll never forget. I'd preached a message. Man, I thought it was a good message. I mean, bless God. He knew what he did when he called me. And I was standing at the back door talking to people. And I, hey, good message. Good. Well, thank you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Glad you like that. Praise the Lord. Yeah, that's the Lord and everything. And a man walks up and he said, you mispronounced that word. I said, what? He said, that's traveleth, not travail. I said, John, that's travail. He said, it's traveleth. I said, no, John. I said, it's travail like a woman having a baby. He said, no, it's traveleth like a person going somewhere. I said, I'll show you. Man, people was bragging on me. I knew I was right. I got my Bible and opened up and he said, where's that? I said, we're right down there. I said, it is traveleth. You know what God did? He goes, you're getting a little haughty, wasn't you? Thought you really done a good job, didn't you? And the rebuke was good for me. Better than all those that came by. Good message, good message. Now don't just come by and rebuke me. But what I'm saying is, sometimes it's better for us to get a rebuke than for a fool to just lay on all the bragging. You notice what he says, like thorns under a pot? The popping of those thorns. Have you ever heard thorns that set on fire? You can put a pot over top of them, and like you're going to cook something, and you can put those thorns under there, set them on fire, and man, they start crackling and popping and crackling and popping. You think, man, I've got a rip-roaring fire going. And guess what? They burn up just like that, and it's over with. He said, that's where your pride is. He said, it'll all burn up just like that and it's over with. We need wisdom. We need wisdom. The only way we're going to get wisdom is to walk with God. Fellas, if there's one thing that if as your pastor, that if I could get you to do, it would be to walk with God. Walk with God. Walk with God. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Father, thank you for loving us. Help us to walk with you. Forgive us of our sin. Lord, I failed you in so many ways. And Lord, may we humble ourselves and may we draw near to you. And help us to have wisdom and understanding. Lord, take control of our lives. With us we pray in Jesus' name.